Penguin Random House Audio presents Flipped, How Georgia Turned Purple and Broke the Monopoly on Republican Power by Greg Bluestein. Read for you by Holter Graham. Prologue. When Georgia Republicans need a go-to venue for a big celebration, there is no shortage of options around Atlanta. Well-appointed conference rooms and lakeside resorts, elaborate ballrooms, the artificial turf of the College Football Hall of Fame in the heart of downtown. But none looms larger than the Intercontinental Buckhead in Atlanta's ritziest neighborhood, towering over luxury malls and boutiques along the city's iconic Peachtree Road. The hotel was the site of the Republican victory party on election night 2020, where hundreds of members of the Georgia GOP sipped overpriced beers and watched returns on oversized screens while in the grip of a pandemic. The crowd had reason to be optimistic. Republicans had shut out Democrats in every presidential election in Georgia since 1996 and hadn't lost a statewide seat since 2006. The Georgia GOP was so dominant that for much of the decade, Democrats struggled to recruit even fringe candidates for some top-tier races, or worse, didn't bother running anyone at all, while Republicans built commanding majorities in the state legislature and maintained control of every statewide office. Stacey Abrams might have caught some off guard in 2018 when the Democrat lost the governor's race to Brian Kemp by fewer than 55,000 votes. But Republicans weren't taking the threat lightly this time. Even President Donald Trump had reluctantly visited the state as part of his whirlwind final campaign tour on November 1st, urging Georgians at a windswept rural airport to defend his administration as he promised a great red wave would swamp Joe Biden and his Democratic supporters across the country. Rows of mask-wearing reporters lined the walls of the Intercontinental's banquet hall, while grizzled activists mingled with college interns as Fox News commentators reported the early returns from a booming speaker system. One Republican state after another had gone Trump's way, as strongholds like Alabama, South Carolina, and then, especially sweet, the contested swing state of Florida, each turned a bright shade of red. In the back of the room, a nervous Brandon Phillips paced between the partygoers. A savvy Republican strategist who had led the president's Georgia operation for about a year during the 2016 cycle, Phillips was as comfortable hunting for wild hogs or spearfishing in shark-infested Gulf Coast waters as he was designing a campaign field strategy. His social media accounts brimmed with photos of his political exploits, none more proudly displayed than the black-and-white picture of him striding down a convention hall corridor with Trump, both grinning from ear to ear with matching thumbs-ups. Since Trump's 2016 victory, Phillips had honed a reputation as a sharp-elbowed brawler with a specialty of helping local candidates try to channel the president's appeal. But there was no trace of that easy smile on Phillips's face on this night, as he scanned the room of tipsy revelers in search of others who shared his trepidation. Cody Hall, a young aide to Governor Brian Kemp, was also milling about the crowd with unspoken anxiety. "They don't even know why they shouldn't be celebrating yet," Hall said, glancing back and forth from an election analysis on his weathered smartphone to the joyful throng in front of him. Trump was winning the states he was expected to win, but he was falling behind in Arizona, and his numbers in Georgia weren't much better. Late that night, as the celebration continued around him, Phillips peered into his phone and groaned. The New York Times needle, the tracking tool designed to predict which candidate was on track to win an election, had suddenly swung decisively toward Biden in Georgia when vote totals from heavily Democratic DeKalb County had started to come in. One nervous operative sequestered himself in an empty conference suite just outside the ballroom and dialed up an election expert. "Are there really enough votes left to swing this thing?" he asked. On the second floor of the hotel, Republican Senator David Perdue's strategists were hunkered down in a war room, poring over numbers that would determine whether the incumbent would win a second term or be forced by Georgia's peculiar state law into a runoff against his Democratic opponent, the investigative filmmaker John Ossoff. Perdue had won office 6 years earlier with a carefully cultivated outsider image that belied his family's deep roots in Georgia politics. Every so often, he'd unpack the iconic jean jacket that had made him a star to Georgia's right, wrap it around his broad shoulders, and take it for a spin on the trail. But the truth was, the former Fortune 500 chief executive was just as comfortable in a finely tailored suit as he was in the worn denim of his campaign ads. Earlier in the night, exhausted aides and strategists in the war room had been bombarded with congratulations on a hard-fought victory. Unbelievable job! It's over! But Perdue's most senior loyalists tamped down the premature celebration. There were still hundreds of thousands of votes to be tallied, and many would be coming from areas where Democrats dominated. One aide bolted upstairs to Perdue's suite, where the senator was preparing for a victory speech, to deliver the news. "Ignore what you're hearing," he told the Republican. "This is going to be very, very close." Perdue sat in stony silence with his wife, Bonnie, for a few heartbeats. But he wasn't surprised. "How much longer will it take?" he asked. In fact, Perdue was painfully aware of troubling data for his campaign and those of other Republicans in Georgia. And he had sounded the alarm early and often, pleading for Trump and national Republicans to send his campaign more resources in the face of an epic election cycle shaped by a pandemic and nationwide movement for social justice. What made the situation more frustrating for Perdue was that his opponent was not another veteran of Georgia's hallowed corporate community, but a political newcomer about the same age as his two sons. To him, Ossoff, a 33-year-old former congressional aide, was little more than a privileged wannabe whose greatest gift was the silver tongue he used to convince liberals to dig into their wallets for campaign donations. On the campaign trail, Perdue couldn't hide his disdain. Ossoff was a trust fund socialist who lives off his family's money making documentary movies that no one's ever watched. Perdue vented at one stop. Behind closed doors, Perdue wasn't any kinder in his assessment of the matchup. He was a former Fortune 500 CEO in the fight of his political life against a little shit who, he claimed, had never created a job. On the road, Perdue drew decent-sized crowds. But his young opponent knew how to strike him where it hurt the most. A debate held about a week before the election left Perdue bloodied and seething after Ossoff dismantled him, calling him a crook during a scathing minute-long monologue that was watched more than 15 million times on social media. "How could I respect a man like that?" Perdue asked his closest friends. In the final sprint, Perdue's team tried to recreate some of the magic of his runaway victory 6 years earlier, a luxury campaign bus stocked with his favorite Chick-fil-A chicken biscuits and wrapped with Perdue's slogan, branding him the original outsider in red, white, and blue glory. The reassuring presence of his wife, a serene grandmother who never envisioned her golden years spent on the campaign trail. A pre-election day fly-around tour that ended at the same suburban Atlanta airport where his first cousin, Sonny Perdue, had launched his successful bid for governor almost two decades earlier. Anything to give him a sense of momentum going into the final stretch. This was never going to be the clean victory Perdue had enjoyed in 2014. But as the returns came in, the senator's senior advisors quietly reckoned that it wasn't going to be any sort of victory at all. The results pointed to a 9-week overtime bout that Republicans dreaded. With the nation's attention turned to the race, anything could happen during the runoff. And if Perdue's seat was in question, then surely Trump's fate was also in doubt. Instead of delivering a finely tuned victory speech, Perdue stayed in his upstairs suite with his wife, leaving it to sullen deputies to deliver the unhappy news that the senator wouldn't be joining the party. Elsewhere around Georgia, other Republican celebrations shared the same deflated ending. At Congressman Doug Collins's gathering near his North Georgia hometown of Gainesville, the music abruptly stopped as fidgety supporters zeroed in on a TV projector.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.